Discovering new blues artists is the name of the game today. I'm going to introduce you to 11 blues guitar players representing a wide range of styles, from Piedmont to ragtime to Mississippi Hill Country. Get ready for today's Acoustic Tuesday show, because you'll be making a shopping list for the next time you visit your local record store. Hey Tack family, this is episode 288 of the Acoustic Tuesday Show, a show packed full of inspiration and fun designed to help you get more progress, fulfillment, and joy from your acoustic guitar journey. Throughout today's episode, I'll be keeping you in the loop with some acoustic news you can use, including a documentary about one of the best modern singer-songwriters, a questionable guitar from the folks at Martin, and much, much more. Plus, you're gonna meet Tack family member Richard, who thought something was absolutely impossible on his guitar journey, but he ended up doing it, and it became a major turning point for him. You'll see what I mean here in a moment, but first, let me bathe your ears in this sonic bubble bath of blues. I've got 11 artists I want to introduce you to. Whether you're brand new to the blues or you're a longtime fan, this list will hold something for you because there are some absolute dandies on here, some guitarists that I just recently discovered here in the last month, and I want to share them with you. And when I say new artists, I'm not saying they just came out. A lot of these artists were born in the very early 1900s, late 1800s. So just to kind of get your head wrapped around the time frame we're dealing with here. Before I get into this list though, do know that in a couple episodes, we're doing an Ask Me Anything episode where you have the opportunity to ask me anything. Episode 290, which will air on May 9th, you have the opportunity to ask me any question you want, quite literally anything. I hope you put me on the spot. I hope you ask a total left field question. And to participate, all you have to do is in the comments below, type in the letters AMA, and then go ahead and ask me your question. I'd love to answer it on that episode. Again, it's gonna be episode 290, airing May 9th, 2023. Okay, first up on my list, Mississippi Fred McDowell. He is one of the most raw voices you'll ever hear. In fact, there's a recording, and I'm unsure of the album, but it's a recording with him and his wife. Is it Annie? I think it's Annie McDowell. Anyways, I don't have it pulled up here for whatever reason. It's a phenomenal recording, and it's just quite simply raw. It's just as raw as raw gets in the best possible way. And I think in a lot of cases, that's what makes the blues. A couple factoids about Mississippi Fred McDowell. He was born January 12th, 1904 in Rossville, Tennessee. His parents were farmers who both died when Fred was in his youth. He took up the guitar at age 14 and was soon playing for tips at dances around Rossville. After decades of playing for small local gatherings, McDowell was recorded in 1959 by roving folklore musicologist Alan Lomax and Shirley Collins on their Southern Journey field recording trip. So let's go ahead and listen to Mississippi Fred McDowell play the song, Going Down to the River. Here he is.
Oh, you know I'm going down to the river, baby. I must sit down on the ground. I'm gonna sit down on the ground. I'm let the waves of water, honey, baby, wash my trouble down.
Bukka White is next on my list, and man, does he have a unique style. A unique style that continued to evolve throughout his playing career. He was born November 12, 1906, south of Houston, Mississippi. Now check out this awesome guitar geek factoid. He was a first cousin of B.B. King's mother. White's mother and King's grandmother were sisters. And in terms of the breadth of his work, it is just, you have to have it all. You quite honestly have to have it all. We're gonna listen to him play the song World Boogie, and this is a very cool video shot by Alan Lomax, and it is Bukka White playing with Howlin' Wolf. And Howlin' Wolf is kind of improvising, I guess, in a way, but man, what a cool moment in the blues world, what a cool moment in the music world, and yes, it does feature Bukka White.
Still, anybody look like they need it bad enough.
Well, I need some money.
Please, ma'am, do that old boogie for me. Old boogie for me.
You're about to hear one of the most beautiful and most haunting voices in all of blues. Skip James, born Nehemiah Curtis James, June 9th, 1902. And I feel like it just takes one line of Skip singing to literally penetrate your core. I don't know the best words to describe it, so you know what? I'm not gonna, because words aren't gonna do it justice. Let's go ahead and listen to Skip James play the song Hard Times Killin' Floor Blues.
You know that people, they are drifting from door to door, but they can't find no heaven. I don't care where they go. So you say you had some money, but you better be sure. No, these hard times got killed you, just drying on soul.
Next up is an artist that I just started listening to, I would say in the last 3 or 4 weeks, Tommy McLennan. Raw, edgy, and just plays the heck out of the guitar. It's almost like he's trying to beat up the guitar. At least that's how it sounds when I listen to it. That's what I kind of imagine. An interesting note on that here in just a moment. I've got a couple of Tommy McLennan facts for you. He was born January 4th, 1905 in Durant, Mississippi. And of Tommy McLennan, Big Bill Brunzi said this. He had a different style of playing a guitar. You just make the chords and change when you feel like changing. It's raw, it's edgy, it keeps you on the edge of your seat. It's a very engaging approach to the blues. And while, you know, I say that, I don't think Tommy was sitting there thinking, gosh, how can I engage my listeners? He quite simply felt the music, and that comes across big time. Here's Tommy McLennan playing the song Whiskey Head Woman.
Now every time I see you, babe, you ask some whiskey joint. Standing around as the crowd is begging for one more half a pint, call you the whiskey-headed woman, and you stay drunk all the time. Baby, if you don't stop drinking, little woman, I believe you're gonna lose your mind. Yeah.
From one Tommy to another, now you're going to hear Tommy Johnson. Born in January 1896, he first recorded in the year 1928 for Victor Records. One of the songs he recorded then was Canned Heat Blues, in which he sang of drinking methanol from the cooking fuel Sterno. And fun fact, the blues group Canned Heat took their name from that very song. And speaking of that song, let's go ahead and listen to it. Here's Canned Heat Blues by Tommy Johnson.
I woke up this morning with canned heat on my mind. Woke up this morning, canned heat was on my mind. Woke up this with canned heat on my mind.
J.B. Lenoir is next. Now, I had never heard of J.B. before 2 weeks ago. And like I said, I've been stuck in the blues rabbit hole. I saw the name Big Bill Brunzi, and then I saw the name J.B. Lenoir, and I thought, if those two names are associated, I should probably learn more, and I'm so glad that I did. JB was born March 5th, 1929. In 1949, yes, at just 20 years old, he moved to Chicago, where Big Bill Brunzi helped introduce him to the blues community. Lenoir was known in the 1950s for his showmanship, particularly his zebra-patterned costumes and his high-pitched vocals. Whatever he wore, it doesn't matter, because you're just going to listen to him right now and you will be hooked just as I am, just as I became. Here's J.B. Lenoir singing the song Alabama Blues.
I never will love Alabama. Alabama seemed to never have love for me. wish you would rise up one day and lead my peoples to the land of peace. My brother was taken up for my mother, and the police officer shot him down.
Now it's time to introduce you to Arthur Blake, better known as Blind Blake. Born in the year 1896, he recorded about 80 tracks for Paramount Records between the years 1926 to 1932. I feel like when you listen to his recordings, you will almost be dumbfounded. I know I certainly was. It seems like he has 7 extra fingers on his picking hand, 7 extra fingers on his fretting hand. His guitar playing is often paralleled to that of a ragtime piano player. There just seems to be so much going on. It's a treat to listen to, and it's truly inspirational to know that there's one guy playing all these parts on the guitar. He didn't YouTube anything. He quite simply played the guitar. He created a style. Just brilliant playing. Let's go ahead and listen to Blind Blake play the song Georgia Bound.
I got the Georgia blue for the plowing home. I got the Georgia blue for the plowing home. Walked out my shoes over this ice and snow.
This next blues player has about, I don't know, 45 different stage names, such as Blind Sammy, Georgia Bill, Hot Shot Willie, Blind Willie, Barrelhouse Sammy, Pig and Whistle Red, Blind Doogie, Red Hot Willie Glaze, Red Hot Willie, Eddie McTeer. And he's most commonly known as Blind Willie McTell. He played a 12-string guitar almost exclusively, and I gotta tell you, man, did he bring it. He was born May 5th, 1898. And I have to say, if you dig Blind Willie McTell's music, do yourself a favor, head over to Third Man Records. There is a 4-volume set of, to the best of my knowledge, all of his recordings. And they are recordings that you're gonna wanna have in your collection for posterity purposes, but also just quite simply to listen to frequently. Like I said, he played a 12-string almost exclusively, and I am just enamored by these old-time blues players. I just am. And you know, I've been listening to this music for a long time, but even still, to this day, I listen to these old players and I'm baffled. There's this magic and almost mysticism surrounding them. And that's certainly the case for Blind Willie McTell. Let's go ahead and listen to him play the song Dying Crapshooter's Blues.
Police walked up and shot my friend the other down. Boy, they gotta die today. He had a game of crapshooter and gambled at his bedside. Here are the words he had to say. Guess I ought to know exactly how I want to go. How you want to go, Jesse? 8 crapshooter to be my pallbearers. Let them be veiled down in black. I want 9 men going to the graveyard, Bubba, and 8 men coming back. I want the gang of gamblers gathered around my coffin's side. Crooked card printed on my hearse. Don't say the crapshooter's ever grave over me. My life been a doggone curse.
The next two artists that I have for you are of the Mississippi Hill Country Blues genre. First up, Jessie Mae Hemphill. Now, I've featured her on the Acoustic Tuesday show before, and I need to do it again because I feel like everyone, plain and simply, needs to know who Jessie Mae Hemphill is. This Mississippi Hill Country Blues is known for its hypnotic effect. It's almost drony. It has these driving, repeated motifs that just kind of suck you into the song. And I got to tell you, Jessie Mae Hemphill is a master at it. From her voice to her guitar playing, it just has this catchy, almost momentum that you cannot ignore. And one such song that features that momentum is the song Streamline Train. Once you hear it, you won't be able to not hear it, and you're going to want to keep hearing it. So let's start hearing it right now.
Say that mean old streamline. Hey, do you hear that whistle blow?
Next up within that Mississippi Hill Country Blues genre is R.L. Burnside, born November 23rd, 1926, and he learned his guitar playing from none other than Mississippi Fred McDowell, who you learned about a little bit earlier today. Now, R.L. Burnside, interesting fact, kind of a sad fact actually, is he didn't get much recognition before the early 1990s. And I feel like that's the case for the majority of these older Delta blues, Piedmont blues musicians. The 60s folk revival, blues revival, kind of started to shine the spotlight on a lot of these older players. It's not that they didn't play, it's just that nobody was listening. And then all of a sudden, everybody was listening. So I'm so happy that that renaissance happened, for lack of a better term there, because a lot of this music was preserved so that we can still enjoy it today. And I think R.L. Burnside is definitely of that same, cut from the same cloth, in that he was, you know, rediscovered, and he has a large breadth of music available. In fact, a lot of the earlier releases that were ironically released after the 90s were of an electric band where I believe he was in with his brother. But he's an artist that you should definitely explore. We're just going to listen to one quick little excerpt here of the song Poor Black Maddie. This is taken from an acoustic concert that he did in, I believe, 1984. It's about a 20 or so minute concert. You can find it on YouTube. If you dig R.L. Burnside, if you want to hear him play acoustic, this is where you need to spend some time. We're just going to look at it, or rather, we're just going to listen to a quick little clip of it right now.
Poor Black Maddie got changing clothes. Girl got drunk, close that door. Poor Black Maddie ain't got changing clothes. Girl got drunk, don't close that door.
Real quick, before I get to the last artist on today's list, correction, that R.L. Burnside concert is actually about an hour long. It's not just 20 minutes. So if you want to dig into R.L. Burnside, if you want to dig into Mississippi Hill Country Blues as a style, that would be a great place to start. You can kind of hear that hypnotic approach, that single repeated riff that cultivates this beautiful momentum. That's a great place to start. So again, that's R.L. Burnside live in 1984. And it just so happens to feature him on an acoustic guitar, which of course is right up my alley and likely up yours as well. Okay, so the last artist on the list for today is Honey Boy Edwards, one of, well, when he was alive, one of the last living links to Robert Johnson. Let me share with you some info about Honey Boy Edwards, and then we'll listen to him play. David Honey Boy Edwards was born June 28, 1915 in Shaw, Mississippi. At the age of 14, he left home to travel with the bluesman Big Joe Williams, beginning life as an itinerant musician, which he maintained through the 30s and 40s. He performed with the famed blues musician Robert Johnson, with whom he developed a close friendship. Edwards was present on the night Johnson drank the poison whiskey that killed him, and his story has become the definitive version of Johnson's demise. Edwards also knew and played with other leading bluesmen in the Mississippi Delta, including Charlie Patton, Tommy Johnson, and Johnny Shines. Now, I have a confession to make. I first heard of Honey Boy Edwards when I was working at the Old Town School. They just released a documentary about his life. I think it's just called Honey Boy, and I can't remember the film company that did it. But I don't know if it was the folks from the film company, they came in to get the store to stock some of these Honey Boy Edwards documentaries. So I think I bought 5 or 6 of them for the store. At that point in time, I was buying like CDs and things, stocking CDs for the store. Anyways, I was all excited. I was like, cool, I'm gonna grab one of these for myself, and then I'm gonna go ahead and learn about Honey Boy Edwards. So I'm learning about Honey Boy Edwards, and I'm listening to him play, and I thought to myself, this was a big mistake. I thought to myself, well, he's not very good. He's just not very good. He doesn't seem to play very cleanly. What a misstep. What a gross, disgusting misstep by me. Because I missed a large part of what went into his playing. It wasn't about being technically proficient. It wasn't about playing clean notes. It wasn't about staying in time. It was about playing the blues and literally living the blues. Honey Boy Edwards lived the blues, and I can see that now, but when I first listened to him, I remember thinking like, man, this, I don't know, I'm not super interested by this. But when you take into account the history, when you take into account the blues as a genre and its history as a music style, one of the biggest regrets I had, one of the biggest, silliest first reactions I ever had. I just wanted to share that with you. I don't know if that shed any light on maybe a reaction you had to an artist or something like that, but I just thought it was interesting to think of that right now as I was talking. I just popped into my head. But I want you to hear David Honeyboy Edwards. He is a national treasure. One of those under the radar ones that you need to know about. You need to know about. And you're going to do that right now. Here he is singing the song, singing and playing the song, Gambling Man.
Lord, I'm a gambling man. I'm a gambling man. Gambling everywhere I go. I'm a gambling man. I'm a gambling man. Nah, nah. Lord, I gamble from door to door. I gamble down in Louisiana. I gamble down on old man in your sugar farm. I gamble down in Louisiana. Gamble down on old man in your sugar farm. But I can't never get lucky just to win my train fare home.
So now, between this week's episode and last week's episode, you have 22 blues musicians to discover and hear for, in some cases, the first time. And on that same topic, I want to know if you dig this show format. Do you like me just listing artists that you need to hear? I've tried to do this in the past and have done it in the past, but I've stuck to very specific genres, kind of niche genres within greater genres. Like maybe I'll do Mississippi Hill Country Blues. Maybe I'll do Delta Blues or Piedmont Blues. What do you think of me just sharing a list of musicians that I think you should know about? Let me know in the comments below. Do you like this style or do you want it to be a little bit more specific? I'm open. I'm all ears. I just want to make the show better and more useful for you. And speaking of the comments, a reminder again, episode 290 will be an Ask Me Anything episode. It will air May 9th, 2023. If you want to ask me a question, do so right now in the comments below. Type the letters AMA and then go ahead and ask me, well, anything you want. Let's dig into some acoustic news you can use. And first up is, of course, my weekly announcement about the Fretboard Summit. The Fretboard Summit is being held August 24th through the 26th at the Old Town School of Folk Music in Chicago. The Fretboard Summit is brought to you by the Fretboard Journal. To get all the details you need to know about, go to fretboardsummit.org. You can see the dates, you can see the costs, you can see everything on there. You can see the lineup, the performer lineup. We're talking Tommy Emmanuel, Jack Broadbent, Jorma Kalkinen. Oh, Bill Frisell is going to be there, amongst many others. Rumor has it Bob Minner's going to be there. Some of the stuff is unconfirmed, but I'm just bursting at the seams here. I am so excited. So again, check that out, fretboardsummit.org. The tickets are limited. So these three-day VIP passes are, I believe they're $350 for 3 days. I want to make sure I get that right. Yeah, $350 for a three-day pass. And there's only 250 of those available. Now, tickets have been on sale for some time, so I think that number is dwindling. There might not be very many left, so if you're thinking about it, maybe a little bit more action, less thinking. I'm just excited. And if you can go, I want you to go. I'll be doing some workshops there in association with the Fretboard Journal as well as Thompson Guitars, so I am delighted. Now let's go ahead and dig into that documentary I referred to right at the beginning of the show. Jason Isbell, whom I think is one of maybe the best modern songwriters ever. I know that's a bold statement, but man, his songs are just the ones that you keep listening to him and you pick up these little nuances. Well, a documentary just came out, and the name of it is Running With Our Eyes Closed. It's on HBO. They released a trailer. I believe it was released just a couple of weeks ago. If you haven't seen it, put it on your list. Here's the trailer.
I won't be satisfied unless this album is an accurate representation of where I am as a person.
I know how he gets when he makes records, whether or not he sees it at the time or not.
most people don't go to work with their wife.
Amanda gives him honest feedback.
I've already went like through this in my brain about
well, this will just be permanently disagreed with. Just sing whatever you want and then think about it later.
No, I want to get it right.
So you're fighting with all these voices inside of your head.
It's kind of driving crazy.
Took forever to get you to trust me. I was feeding a bird from my hand.
April Fool's Day was just a few short weeks ago, and I feel like the guitar industry was abuzz with various pranks. I'm just going to share a few of my favorites with you right now. Gibson announced the nitrocellulose candle, scented with notes of rock and roll. The caption says, Gibson Custom Shop is excited to announce the limited edition nitrocellulose candle. This candle will transport you to the moment you first picked up your guitar, now scented with notes of rock and roll. Certainly piqued my interest. I was like, that'd be cool. And then I realized it was April Fool's Day. They followed that up with a limited run nitrocellulose cologne. Smells as good as a Gibson sounds. You can interpret that however you want. The caption says, Gibson is proud to announce our limited edition nitrocellulose cologne with notes of leather, patchouli, and confidence. This cologne will have you feeling like a rock star in your everyday life. Again, another dandy from them. And then Epiphone, of course, chimes in, and they posted this picture of a relict guitar. And the caption says, Epiphone is thrilled to announce the all-new master-built woodpecker, inspired by nature's edgiest bird. Disclaimer, holes in distressing may vary based on woodpecker's temperament. Just funny stuff. And then to cap it all off, you know, quite a few episodes ago on the show, I mentioned Michael Watts. He's got various podcasts out, one in conjunction with the Fretboard Journal. He does a lot of content on YouTube, and it's just an all-around great player, great guitar personality, and man, does he have a voice. And I believe on the show I referenced his work, I said, I think I would hire Michael Watts to sit by my bedside and read me guitar spec sheets as I dozed off to sleep. Well, April Fool's Day, my wish, my dream was honored. Michael Watts took what I asked him to do to a whole new level. Here it is. I would simply hire Michael Watts to sit by my bedside and read me guitar spec sheets as I was falling asleep. His voice is soothing, it's relaxing. That's really not the point. That's just a hidden benefit. This is a great podcast. The first episode.
Martin Guitar Company, established 1833, D45 model. Body size, a dreadnought with a dovetail neck joint. Forward shifted X-brace, scalloped, and a scale length of 25.4 inches.
Okay, go ahead and grab your guitar. Now it's time to see what the Tack family is working on today. Each week within Tony's Acoustic Challenge, the Tack family rotates through the five essential skills that are involved in learning any song, and learning any song fast. On Monday, the Tack family focuses on a technique challenge, Tuesdays, a guitar lick, Wednesdays, an improvisation challenge, Thursdays, a rhythm guitar challenge, and Fridays, a chord transition challenge. Today is Tuesday. The Tack family is working on a guitar lick, and here it is. Today's Tuesday Tack Guitar Lick Challenge is named Lucille because it's modeled after B.B. King's playing. One of the things I love about B.B.'s playing is that it's sparse, yet it fills musical space. You know, all too often you think, oh, I gotta fill all this space with all these notes. Not in BB's world. And today we're gonna take a cue from BB. Let me go ahead and play this lick for you so you can hear what it sounds like, and then I'll show you some different uses for it. And this lick is really like a 12 for one special. I'll show you what I mean here in a moment, but first, here's the lick. It just screams BB. Yes, we're not doing this on an electric guitar, but it doesn't matter. That series of notes, that space, that vibrato, all screams BB King. Now, I wanna show you how to use this in a musical context, but first, Tack family, please log in. This is your daily challenge. You can learn it note for note. Click on the teaching video. That'll go right to the teaching video where I click on start. That'll take you to the teaching video. That's where I'll teach it to you note for note, then move to the play along video. Adjust it to a speed that's comfortable for you, and don't forget to click on that tab icon in the lower right hand corner. That'll allow you to pull up the tab right next to the video. Okay, so this lick, two specific instances I want to share with you. One has much larger implications on your playing as a whole. I'll save that powerful nugget to the end, but you can actually use this as a fill. Now, it seems a little odd because usually fills happen where we're playing the chords. But if you're playing chords like B.B. King does often, where there's these stops involved, it gives you space to move up the guitar neck. And when I talk about playing chords like B.B. does, here, I'm just going to play you a quick little rhythm so you can kind of hear what it sounds like. Okay, here's kind of a quintessential B.B. rhythm. It has these wonderful stops. And the chords aren't ringing, and thank goodness because they're bar chords, but it has these wonderful stops that kind of allow for space. So as you're playing that rhythm, you can kind of plug in this lick. Here's how that would sound. So those stops and kind of that space to breathe allows you to just plug in this lick and give your listener a little bit more of a another layer to explore, another sonic layer to explore. Now, I said that this lick is a 12 for one special, a very rare sale that almost never happens. But since this lick is fully closed, not fully clothed, but fully closed, meaning there are no open strings involved, you can actually move it wherever you want to play it in whatever key you want, right? So here I'm playing it in the key of A. Right, that's in the key of A. If I wanted to move it to the key of G, I would just drop it 2 frets. So instead of starting at the 10th fret, I'd start at the 8th fret. It's in G. If you wanted to play it in B, you'd bump it up 2 frets. So when you look at these closed position licks, meaning all of the notes are fretted, immediately a little bell should go off in your brain that says, oh, I can move this to whatever chord, whatever key I want. That's the beauty of these closed position licks. And so often on acoustic guitar, I want to say it's maybe a little bit harder to explore these closed position licks because they don't lend themselves to ease of incorporation when it comes to playing chords, but in this case, in this scenario, it certainly does. So I hope you really dug this lick, and I hope you get your BB on here. And speaking of, you know, playing like certain players, I just want to mention, you know, sometimes you might hear grumblings, or you might feel like it's frowned upon to imitate your favorite players. No, that's part of learning the language. You know, when you're a kid and you're growing up, chances are you talk like your parents because you're learning the language. And as you grow older, you might lose a certain dialect or like a Midwestern accent or something like that. You might lose that as you grow older because you're finding your own way. The same is true for guitar. When you're learning guitar, it is absolutely paramount that you listen to other players, that you copy other players, and do so in a way that you're conscious of the fact that you're learning the language, right? You're learning the language by example. And you can take these things and tweak them on your own, but you have to start somewhere. And I think copying great players is a fantastic starting point. So next time you're learning something, it might be this, it might be something else. If you feel like you're copying a great player, good, do that. But always know that you're doing it in that greater perspective of, I'm eventually gonna put my own twist on this and find my own voice. Okay, back to the show. Speaking of the TAC family, I want to introduce you to TAC family member Richard. Richard is from Winnipeg. At the time of me filming this, the Winnipeg Jets are battling for a playoff spot, so I hope indeed that by the time this episode comes out, that Winnipeg is firmly locked into a playoff spot. But if they're not, I'm sorry, maybe they can golf with the Chicago Blackhawks. Anyways, I had a chance to talk with Richard during the last Tony's Acoustic Challenge Live 90-day progress party, and we were talking about his guitar journey, and he told me, he took an aside and he said, you know what? Last quarter, I committed to doing something, and I didn't want to do it. but I ended up doing it. And the ramifications that that action had on his playing as a whole were huge. I'll let Richard tell you the story.
I want to add one thing about when you say about the goals, and where it really resonates about having a commitment and then being held accountable. I know it was a couple of sessions ago, when I say sessions, the 90-day sessions, and I publicly stated my goal was to, because I'm afraid or have a fear of playing in front of others, is that I would learn a song, I would record it, and I would post it to, your the TAC website.
Yeah.
And I know I was playing to nail this song over and over again. And I was thinking to myself, darn it, why did I commit to this? But the flip side was, if I hadn't have committed to it publicly, I don't think I would have completed it. But I did, I posted it, and the side benefit, which I never thought of, and it's been referenced by other about how great the TAC community is. So I posted the song Billy in the Low Ground, and all of a sudden I start getting all these comments from TAC members about my playing, and talk about encouraging one to play more. Yeah, that was really a wonderful experience, Tony. I didn't expect it, but it was really something special.
How incredible is that? I think we've all had that feeling before where we maybe have committed to something that involves guitar or guitar playing, and while we're working towards it, we think to ourselves, maybe I shouldn't do that, but I committed to it. Ugh. But then you end up doing it, and it's one of the... And it ends up being almost a turning point in your guitar journey. So I'm so happy that Richard shared that with me. And furthermore, I asked him, how did it feel once you did it and once you got feedback? Did that have any other impact on your guitar journey in other ways maybe you didn't see coming? And it certainly did. Here's what he had to say.
Oh, absolutely. Because having done that, saying, wow, this is fun. I want to learn more. I want to learn more songs. And be able to play with others. One of the things, with COVID really couldn't do was play with others. Mm-hmm. But I, in the chat session, I mentioned how I discovered by accident my neighbor plays guitar. And now we get together every Wednesday. And that is so much fun to play together. We're not good enough to take it on the road, so we just play for ourselves. But we have a lot of fun.
I'm so excited for Richard and his guitar journey as a whole, and I'm so thankful that he chose to share that story with me and, of course, with all of you guitar geeks, because I do feel that we need to be reminded that, it might feel like the walls are closing in and we can't do that thing that we set out to do. But Richard is proof that if you keep your eyes on the prize, if you follow through, good things will come. Yes, it doesn't mean it's not scary, but holy smokes, look at how Richard made out. And I want that for you as well. So again, huge thanks to Richard. On to your second dose of acoustic news you can use. And first up, we've been talking about the blues a lot on the show, and I found this guitar from Blind Guitars, a maker out of France, that is just the perfect cross-section of modern luthery with classic design, inspired by some of the old blues guitars. Think of some of those old Gibson oval hole arch top guitars. Just beautiful. I just wanted to quite simply show this picture to you because I just admire someone who can take the advancements of modern luthery and the inspiration of classic design and somehow mash them together in a way that gives a nod to both, a nice respectful nod to both. It's not cheesy at all. It doesn't seem forced. It's just darn right beautiful. So cheers to you, Blind Guitars. Again, I think they are in France. Next up, Molly Tuttle just did a string of shows in California. and she had a chance to sit down with, I believe, a 1940 D-28 that was at Griffin Strings. I think it was a D-28, I'm pretty sure. Let me look. But while I'm looking for the details of this, I want to also mention that on that string of California shows, Christina Vane opened up for Molly Tuttle and Golden Highway. And I just thought that was so cool because Christina Vane is one of my favorite blues players. We're talking about blues. She's definitely a modern blues player, but wow. She knows the genre inside and out. And to have her open up the show for Molly, how cool is that? And I think she came on later in the show and joined them. I mean, just rad stuff. Okay, so here it is. Molly Tuttle played... Oh, shoot, I just lost it. Molly Tuttle played this 1940 D-28 at Griffin Strings when she was in California, and this guitar is just a cannon. And then, of course, you hand it to somebody like Molly Tuttle, and, well, it's just a match made in heaven. Here she is. Oh boy. Okay. I got two things left for you. I know this news segment's maybe a little bit longer than usual, but something just came out and I had to share it with you. But I first have to go over this guitar that was made by the folks at Martin. Just going to tell you right now, I don't like it. I think it's very uninspired. Sorry, I have to be honest. It's the Martin D42 Bitcoin. I'll read what is written about this guitar. Created as a nod to the latest global currency, the D42 Bitcoin includes a 1 ounce solid gold token coin embedded in the headstock and unique inlays on the fingerboard and headstock. I guess, you know what? Hey, for the right person, maybe this is kind of cool. I am definitely not the right person. I'm not. I don't know who is. But if you're out there, congrats. This guitar is definitely for you. Let me know what you think about this guitar in the comments below. Would you play it? Would you not play it? I would be of the not playing it variety. But hey, like I said, this guitar could be very well important for somebody out there. And if that's the case, I hope they find it and I hope they get it. Okay. Now on to something that I am excited about. You know, I talked about the Mississippi John Hurt documentary for some time. I think I've mentioned it a couple different times on the show here, and it's still going on. There's a GoFundMe currently active for a Mississippi John Hurt documentary, something that I believe personally the guitar industry needs. Plain and simple, period, end of statement. Now, they just released a trailer, and I just kind of randomly bumped into this. I didn't know that the production was this far along. The name of the documentary, Hurt, A Mississippi Inspiration. And I do have to tell you. Seeing this documentary got me so excited for the potential of this project. Beautifully shot, and I think they got some heavy hitters in terms of interviews here. Let's go ahead and watch the trailer right now.
John Hurt had an enormous effect on me. And part of it was musical, and part of it was another element.
When I heard the recordings, I thought that it rubbed against my ears so good that I almost couldn't stand it. It just goes right in you.
I'm satisfied, tickled too.
Mississippi John Hurt is part of the bedrock of American popular music. It goes way back.
It influenced jazz, it influenced rock and roll, it has influenced every American music genre.
The first time I heard John, it scared the hell out of me because there was too many things going on to be able to imitate it.
I did all I can do. And I can't get along with you.
I read in the Bible, it says, the older men teach the younger ones. I'm glad I got something that they won't.
Here he was coming to New York and playing like nobody else we ever heard. But somehow, something about it just touched our hearts.
It's good for that music to get inside your spine and rise up and make you feel good.
It his voice comes across as being so loving, so caring, so sincere. He is loved all around the world.
All I remember is not so much for his music, but as my grandpa. He just happened to be a person who played the guitar and he was the entertainment, but he always intrigued me all of my life.
The legacy is something she has to fight for, to keep it in existence. There's a story to be told beyond the music.
You got your own that lonesome valley. Well, you got your own it for yourself. Ain't nobody here can walk it for you. You got to walk the bed valley for yourself.
A legend? So much more than that. It's history.
And for more details on that documentary, you can just head on over to GoFundMe, search Mississippi John Hurt, and I think you'll be able to find that fundraiser there. And please participate if you can. And if you can't make a monetary donation, don't worry about it. Just spread the word about the fundraiser. It certainly helps big time. Quick update, you know that Michael Hedges documentary, Oracle, they actually fulfilled their funding. Right? So by virtue of fundraising, they actually exceeded their goal, which is really, really exciting. I can't wait for that one too. So much good stuff going on. So thanks to those of you who spread the word about that and took part in that fundraiser. I want you to do the same for the Mississippi John Hurt one. And on that note, on those wonderful, wonderful finger-picked notes, let me go ahead and wrap up the Acoustic Tuesday show for today. But first, let's take a sneak peek into next week. And next week, we did it once. It was cool. We did it twice. It was really neat. We're going to do it three times. Next week on the Acoustic Tuesday show is part three of the Acoustic Blues Bonanza, where I provide to you a list of blues guitar players you absolutely must know. Yeah, we're essentially creating a shopping list for the next time you go to your local record store. That's what's happening next week on the Acoustic Tuesday show. Remember, you can catch Acoustic Tuesday every single Tuesday at 10 a.m. Mountain Time. Before I let you go, please do remember this. Your guitar success, however you define it, is directly related to your guitar routine. So please invest the time in developing your guitar routine and make sure to have fun every single day that you play. Fun should indeed be your top priority. Thank you so much for joining me today. Thank you for sharing your valuable time with me. And I'll see you next Tuesday on the Acoustic Tuesday show. Cheers to you. The Guitar Geeks Unite.